Journalist Roxana Saberi made headlines last year when she was imprisoned in Iran. The charge was espionage. The sentence, 8 years in jail. She was released after 4 months when an appeals court reduced the sentence. Before her arrest, Saberi had been working as a freelancer for a number of news outlets, despite Tehran revoking her press credentials in 2006. A dual American and Iranian citizen, Saberi has kept relatively quiet about her experience in prison, but now she's sharing her story in a new book, Between Two Worlds, My Life and Captivity in Iran. Roxana Saberi is your connector of the day.
Roxana's book, Between Two Worlds, hit the shelves just last week. I spoke to her a little earlier about her ordeal and began by asking why she felt it was important to put pen to paper. This is what she said.
I think that my experiences are shared by many people who are wrongly imprisoned in Iran. There are many people in prison who are just peacefully pursuing their basic rights, like freedom of expression, freedom of religion, freedom of association. And I wanted the world to know that what happened to me is a pattern for many people who go through that system. It's unjust, from the detention to the trial. And many of them are experiencing much worse than what I went through.
Fascinating stuff. We've got some questions from the viewers for you. Izzo writes in and says, what are some of the conditions that you experienced in your time in Iran? Can you describe the experience?
I was held in solitary confinement for about 2 weeks, and during that time, it was a small cell, maybe 7 by 9. Slept on the floor on a couple of blankets. The floor is cement. There's a thin carpet on top of it. There's one small window near the top. Of the room near the ceiling, but it's out of reach and it has metal mesh on it. And you don't get books, you get the Quran. When I was released from prison, some people asked if I was tortured, and I said, well, they didn't physically harm me, so I guess not. But some human rights activists told me that, yes, there's something called white torture. It means that it doesn't leave a mark on the body, but it can devastate the mind and the conscience. And this is a combination of manipulation and intimidation, cutting you off from the outside world, putting you in solitary confinement, not allowing you an attorney, not allowing you access to your family. And this happens a lot to many other prisoners. And so that the captors can put the maximum amount of pressure on you.
You talked about not even being able to write notes in prison. You were given nothing. Was it a difficult experience writing this book afterwards, going back over what you've been through?
Sometimes it was. I would get very angry at my captors for what they did to me. I would get angry at those people for what they were doing to my cellmates. One of my cellmates was a diabetic, and she was detained because she had gone to her local bakery and shouted, "We want bread." She wanted to get out of prison so badly that she went on a hunger strike. And I was in a cell alone with her for a few days, and I thought she was going to die. As one of my cellmates put it, she said, "Roxana, when you go back to America, please tell others that our country is not only about the nuclear issue, it's also about people like us."
Bimal writes in and asks, what motivates you to do your job every single day? And what is it like to be a journalist in what is, as many people perceive, to be the one of the most dangerous places in the world?
Well, in Iran, I was motivated because the country is a mysterious, exciting place and full of news stories and important news stories. And I felt very rewarded when I provided, when I shared information about what's happening in Iran with other countries, viewers and listeners from around the world. It is a riskier place to report than, say, America in general, but I think it's in closed societies like that where journalism and talking to people, interviewing people, and sharing their views with the rest of the world, which is what I was trying to do in a book that I was writing about Iran at the time I was arrested, where these things can be the most important.
Munir Ahmed has written to us. He says, glad to communicate with you, Roxana. What are your opinions regarding reconciling Iranian and U.S. Views?
Well, I think that the door to dialogue should always remain open. One, because if you close it, then it seems like you're really narrowing the possibilities of a peaceful solution. But I think that even as America and other countries in an international community pursue the nuclear issue, they always have to keep human rights as a first-tier issue and not a second or a third-tier issue.